all the discussion of the spin one field, so that the next time we can start with interactions. Okay? So last time we finished with writing down what was the propagator, the two-point function of the mu field. Today I'll start from there. And in particular, I remember in the whole discussion, at the beginning of the discussion of the quantization of the mu field, I put the xi parameter, which I introduced the cage fixing term, to the preferred choice xi equal to 1, which will simplify some of the calculation. And I commented that it doesn't matter since at the end the xi term was multiplying the operator the mu and mu, that the physical state would be 0. So whatever value you choose, at the end of the day, if you only consider gauge invariant operators and physical states, you'll get the same result. However, imagine that now you want to repeat the computation with the different values of xi. I will not redo the full quantization with the different xi. You can imagine that you get an intermediate step with a different, but at the end, similar, qualitatively similar result. But I'll just write for you what would be the form of the two-point function, because this is, at the end, is the object that will enter in the future of the calculations of the variables we are interested in. In the case, this xi parameter now is not 1, but it's a generic number. So in particular, I want to compute for xi generic what is the time order product between a mu x a mu y in the vacuum. So how to compute this? Well, a mu is a solution to the field equation. And now if xi is generic, it's not equal to 1, the field equation, you remember, was slightly different. They were the form of box g mu nu minus 1 over xi d mu d nu a mu equal to 0. So which means that if you want, if I call this object the Green function between this is mu and u of x minus y, this Green function must satisfy the condition, the equation of motion applied to the Green function, like this, is equal to the delta function. Take derivative to x, apply to the two-point function x minus y, and this gives me delta 4. You can recover the same expression just by the fact that you just apply this operator to here. When it applies, when this operator applies inside the mu, you get 0. But then you get an extra contribution when the derivative up to the theta function that is inside the time order, and then it produces a delta function. Some commutator give you the alpha delta 3, and you get exactly this. So as usual, you can take a Fourier transform. I'll just sketch the derivation into all the steps. If you take the Fourier transform, you get a condition which is minus p squared from box. Okay, when you take the derivative of e to the minus I px inside here, g nu nu minus 1 minus 1 over xi, each of these give you ai p mu, so here you get the plus p mu p nu. Here you get a Fourier transform of g, which is equal to g tilde of nu rho now it's a function of p. And this must match with this. The Fourier transform of delta 4 is 1. So you get I delta mu rho. As usual, you get now an algebraic equation for the Fourier transform that you can invert. And now you have a tensor for however here, mu rho. So G of P on mu rho could have two different forms. So G tilde must be something that is depends on P and has two Lorentz indices. So the most general object you can construct with P, with two indices, can be, for example, let me call it first A of P square. P square is the invariant, so a generic function of P square, times G mu nu plus B of P square P mu P mu. This is the most general object you can write out of the four vector P that transform as a tensor.
How do we know that it transforms as a tensor?
Who?
The G mu nu.
Oh, because it comes from here. A transforms like a vector, so the product of two vectors transforms like a tensor. So this is the most general form for an object that depends on P and transforms as a rank 2 tensor. So all you have to do now, you take these answers, you plug inside the equation. If you plug inside the equation, you get two types of terms, terms that are proportional to PP, and terms that are proportional to G mu, nu, or the Kronecker term, depends if they have higher or lower indices. So in this equation, since it must hold for any P, both the term proportional to PP must be equal left and right, and the terms proportional to G mu nu must be equal left and right. So you get two equations, and the two equations fixes exactly A and P and B as a function of P squared. So you can make the exercise, you'll find that A of P squared is equal to minus I over P squared, and B of P squared is equal to I over P to the 4 times 1 minus Xi. So I can just put them in and check that indeed they satisfy the equation. So now you take them inside here. Well, this is the Fourier transform, so you just have to write the Fourier transform of this, which at the end gives the following form. So there is an I, let me put it outside, minus G mu plus 1 minus Xi P mu P mu over P square over P square. So this is the form for the two-point functions in the general psi gauge, the general values of the psi parameter. So as expected, for psi equal to 1, this term drops, and you recover the form we obtained also last time. And now for general psi, you see that the expression depends on psi, not trivially. And this is compatible with the fact that, after all, this object is not gauge invariant, so it will give something that might depend on this parameter, on physical parameter Xi. But you can check that if you consider object as gauge invariant, the dependence on psi drops. Last time, you remember, we commented on the fact that, for example, if here you consider two-point function of the product a mu g mu, which was integrated with the four x was gauge invariant. This was gauge invariant. So if you compute the same thing, it means that you're now multiplying by g mu, this object, and integrating over the four x. So this means that if you multiply by g mu, integrate by the four x, this will give you, in this case, the product p mu g mu, which correspond to d mu g mu, which are zero if g mu is conserved. So these terms, these indices are contracted with conserved currents, disappears, and indeed the dependence on psi also disappears. But in more complicated situations, where this might be saturated to objects that are not gauge invariant, but gauge invariant is restored only at the end. So it might happen that this term doesn't drop immediately, but it will drop only through cancellation with other terms. It depends how complicated is the computation you are going to do with this. So it depends how this object will enter in the final calculation. You will see that sometimes things are not immediate. So sometimes, in the actual computation, this psi parameter is left free. In this way, the calculation becomes more complicated because you have more terms. But at the end of the calculation, you can check that the dependence on psi disappears. So this is give you a cross-check that you didn't make any mistakes. Well, you didn't make obvious mistakes. But often it happens that in computer calculation you have many, many, many pieces with non-trivial dependence on psi, and the dependence on psi only cancel at the end of the calculation when you sum all the pieces together. So that will give you a very strong constraint that you didn't mess up any sign or coefficients. Questions?
There is another guess that is used normally beyond the Feynman.
Yeah, there are many. There are axial gauge, or there is Coulomb gauge, there are Lightcon gauge. There are many, many different gauges. And for several calculations, they're often better than this, in the sense that there are gauges that automatically kills all the unphysical degrees of freedom, you only kept with the two propagating ones. But all these other gauges also break Lorentz explicitly, in the sense that these are constraints that you put to the field mu. For example, one is a naught equal to zero gauge. And of course, this is not a Lorentz invariant constraint. So this is, you remember, the zero component, this was the problematic one with the unbounded from below classical space. You can just put it to zero. Of course, you can always choose, right, a gauge transformation, whatever a naught you have, such that lambda dot cancels exactly that a naught. So it's a valid gauge. Of course, it's not gauge invariant. So it means that if you employ all these other gauges type, you typically get calculations that are not manifestly gauge invariant. Lorentz invariant. But it doesn't matter because at the end of the day, it's just a gauge fixing. You never really broke Lorentz symmetry. The physics is invariant under the gauge transformation you perform. So even if you perform a gauge fixing that is non-Lorentz invariant, it's okay. But of course, in the calculation, then you have to get rid of all the nice simplification that arise by the fact that you can treat everything Lorentz invariantly. So for some calculation, it doesn't matter. And at the end, it becomes easier with this other type of gauge fixings. So in my discussion last time, I fixed I chose the gauge, which was the covariant one, the mu and mu equal to zero, and then which is not the easiest one to discuss quantization, because you saw that to see that the other degrees of freedom, which was left by the gauge fixing, does not intervene, to require all this definition of physical states and so on. But in that discussion, Lorentz symmetry was manifest at all steps. You can repeat the computation, the derivation with the Lorentz non-invariant gauge fixing, and then you get a similar conclusion. But
In the propagator, for example.
Yes.
We normally use that.
You mean just xi?
Uh-huh.
Yes. For that, xi equal to 1 is still convenient in the sense that it removes this part. There are other choices. You can choose 2, 3, 0. One choice that is, especially is xi equal to 0. Because in this case, this term disappeared. And I can check that if
it will be a singularity in the Lagrangian if epsilon.
It's a singularity in the Lagrangian. It's okay. Let me finish. If xi is equal to 0, it's particular because if you now consider the mu j mu nu of x, this gives you 0. The mu and g mu nu correspond here to saturated with p mu. So you get here p mu, here you get p square over p square p nu, and this cancels with this. Which was, you remember, was exactly what we computed last time. We in saying that you get the mu and mu, the mu was actually not zero. Mm-hmm. But in this gauge, with xi equal to zero, this is zero. So it's basically the gauge which makes the mu and mu equal to zero, also on the vacuum states. And sometimes it's useful to have this kind of relation. Yes, it's xi equal to zero is a singularity. What does it mean? It means that in the Lagrangian, this term has an infinitely big coefficient. So you are giving an infinitely big weight to this term, and this actually is forcing the mu and mu really to be zero, because it's like a very large weight. So this is maps. This is it. What I'm saying is much more obvious with the path integral, but that you will see the next semester, but after all, as I said, physics do not depend on psi, so you can choose any value, because after all, on the physical state, the mu mu is anyway zero. So in this type of calculation, you're also allowed to take the psi. Any other questions? Complain?
When you do computations with finite diagrams, you always, at least, I only have seen that they use this psi equal to zero. Is there?
No, typically it's the preferred choice is psi equal to one.
Sorry. That
psi equal to one. Yes, yeah, because you have less than. In the calculation,
okay.
So at the end it doesn't matter, but sometimes calculations are repeated with a psi different from 1 just to check that the result is correct. Typically, you have, sometimes you have hundreds, thousands of tens, and it's easy to make mistakes. So. It's typically, it's only used as a cross check, because after all, you know that physics should be by.
I've seen many inventions in different books about Spin-1P.
About?
Spin-1P. And some books say this equation is useful in the interaction, and this one's useful in some other thing. So it's confusing. So it's not a question, it's a complex. So which one is I should stick to maybe in this context now? Which Lagrangian?
Lagrangian, you mean?
This one, minus the one over four.
This one?
Yeah. Some other books use some different Lagrangian.
Ah, for the Vinch fixing, you mean?
No, no, in general.
For
example, there is a Lagrangian which is partial nu a nu contracted with partial nu a nu. That's it. Without f nu nu squared.
You mean the mu a nu squared?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is when you take psi equal to 1. Mm-hmm. This guy removed the terms from here and you exactly this.
So that, oh yeah. This Lagrangian is already
gauge fixed.
Gauge fixed.
Yes. Yes, if it's not gauge invariant, it means that it has been gauge fixed.
Okay.
In fact, I will comment a little bit more at the end of the lecture about the relation between gauge invariant and gauge fixed Lagrangian. Okay? So I will erase this. Okay, so as a step forward the discussion of interactions, I will now discuss how to implement interactions for gauge fields, for spin 1 fields. So for the other ones, for spin 0 and spin 1 half, interactions are easy to build. You just add the terms in your Lagrangian, which are compatible with Lorentz invariant, and involve higher powers of fields. So for scalar fields, you go in Feynman fields, you just add terms that are more than quadratic, cubic, quartic, and so on. So those are all type of interactions. As long as each term you write transforms as a Lorentz scalar, that is a valid interaction that you can write. For gauge fields, there is an extra constraint because Lorentz invariance only holds if the theory is also gauge invariant, as we argued. So you cannot just write any combination of your A mu field with another vector, it will also be gauge invariant. So I will spend probably half an hour or so discussing how to build gauge invariant interaction terms with the spin 1 fields. So, well, we already saw last time that if you have, you can actually write a term which is A mu coupled to the current J mu. If the current is conserved, then despite the fact that the mu transform with a shift under gauge transformation in d mu lambda, up to total derivative because of conservation of currents, that term was vanishing. So this will be a valid interaction term. J mu can be any local operator that transforms as a vector and is made of fields, for example, and satisfy this condition. Well, we know already examples of conserved currents made of fields. For example, we can take our beloved Dirac Lagrangian, right? You can add a vector, a gauge field, f mu. This term here, the Lagrangian, has a conserved current, right? There is a U1 symmetry under which psi transforms with a phase, which is producing the conserved current operator of the form psi bar, gamma mu, psi. Which means that now we can use this operator here, which is a conserved current, and couple it to our AMU field. So we can add a term here, which is just Q, A mu, psi bar, gamma mu, psi. And this is still compatible with gauge invariant. Of course, you can add also the gauge fixing term. This is the last time I will do. In the future, imagine that there is always this term, but I will not rewrite every time. Okay. Very good. So we have the Lagrangian with free fermion plus the Lagrangian of a free spin one field, massless, and then an interaction term, which is compatible with gauge invariant. So this theory here is the most general Lagrangian, local gauge invariant, Lorentz invariant for a massless spin one field and a massive one alpha field that involves operators with dimensionality equal or less than 4. I will comment why we focus on operators of dimensionality equal or less than 4 at the end of the course. For the moment, let's just assume that we are only interested in this type of operators. This is the most general Lagrangian. This is pretty simple with this matter content. And this is the QED Lagrangian, which means all electromagnetic interaction are encoded to here, which means that this simple, these three terms, basically these four terms in this Lagrangian here, describe all chemistry, condensed matter, biology, everything you see. They all just arise from this interaction term. So the rest of the course will mostly be about understanding how this term produce non-trivial interactions and what kind. Okay. Okay, so it seems quite simple to write gauge invariant interactions. What about if you had a scalar field, right? We saw that in the case of complex scalar field, also there is a U1 symmetry with a conserved current. So we can try to use that one to actually build the interaction between charged spin zero fields, spin zero field, and our photon, okay? Spin one field. So in that case, your starting Lagrangian is d mu phi modulus square, again f mu square term. Okay, and now I want to write something like this, right? So try to write a mu, j mu. J mu, if you remember, was of the form iq, maybe with a minor, whatever, and then there is phi dagger d mu double arrow phi. Right? This was the conserved current for the complex V1 scalar. And you can also add some self-interaction in this case for the scalar field, which are automatically U1 by mass interactions and so on. Unfortunately, there is a problem in this case, because why?
Minus 7.
Huh? No. Which one?
Of the second term.
This one? Or this one?
This one?
No, this has always been minus, right? Remember, the minus there was because we wanted the plus for the spatial components, mm-hmm. and then you get a minus for the time component, but then time component was removed by the gauge fixing with constraint. So no, the linear kinetic term, there is no problem, right? Problem is here, in our interaction term, because only apparently is gauge invariant. So the problem is the following, right? We want to couple mu to a conserved current. This guy here is the conserved current of this Lagrangian. But now if you add this term in the Lagrangian, this is not the conserved current anymore. Because the conserved current was dl in d mu phi r delta phi r. Now I added a term which involves d mu phi, so my dl in d mu changes. This was not happening here. Right? Here I didn't add any d mu psi, so the current, even adding this term, did not change it. So this is still the conserved current. But this is not true anymore here. I added this term, and this term affects what is the conserved current. So if I add this term, this guy here is not conserved current anymore. Okay, let me recompute the conserved current when I add this, okay? So if I compute the conserved current, I have the old piece coming from the mu phi here, which was the same q I phi dagger d mu phi. But then I have an extra piece when I do the d mu phi of this term here. So here I have a d mu phi here, which give me a mu iq phi dagger, and then I have to multiply delta phi, which was again iq phi. So this was iq squared phi. Plus the same for phi dagger. So it gives me a factor of 2. You can repeat the same and give it the same factor. So the conserved current is not just this piece. There is an extra piece which is proportional to mu. Sorry, mu should be up. It's q squared phi dagger phi. Okay, but then means that here I should have put the whole thing. Okay, so let me rewrite here a mu iq phi dagger d mu phi, and then I add, no, let me write it, sorry, let me add it together. Then a mu times this, which is a mu, there's a q squared there, and phi modulus square. So I have a mu times the bit before, then a mu times the new current, which is proportional to mu. So I have a mu square, phi modulus square, q squared. Unfortunately, this is not good enough.
It's not gauge invariant
because when I did the exercise here, I assumed that under a gauge transformation, a mu goes in a mu plus d mu lambda. Then I had the j mu, which was not transforming. And then this up to the total derivative is lambda d mu j mu, which is zero. But now, our expression for j inside has an a mu, which is also gauge transforming. So there will be an extra piece in the gauge transformation inside here, times something. So it's not enough that d mu j mu is zero because there is this extra piece here. It's never ending. It's not that easy. No, the mass lemma will not work, right? Because if I add a mu times a constant, if I do a gauge transformation, the shift, this will be phi dependent, it will be m dependent, it will not cancel. What do we do? Now let's notice first the following.
Is it also true for fermionic field?
No. For fermionic, no. The fermionic, this all work. Because in the first place, after you add this term will not change what is the conserved current. Because this term will not involve the mu psi. The conserved current is dl in d mu psi delta psi. And adding this term to a Lagrangian will not change this guy, because this term in the Lagrangian does not depend on d mu psi. So the current which is conserved is still this, so I don't need to do anything. It's only for the scalar that the problem, okay? Okay, let me notice something. Let's go back to the original argument, right? In here, all I needed is that the constraint was telling me that, let me write the Lagrangian as in general form as something that depends on the field, phi r, its derivative, and the gauge field, mu. Okay, its derivative, that doesn't play a role, okay? Under a gauge transformation, this Lagrangian, right, goes into this. So in order to be gauge invariant, these two terms need to match. So in particular, if you take lambda infinitesimally small, you get the constraint that dl in d a mu times d mu lambda is 0. I tell you expand this at the first order. I get this constraint, which is exactly the constraint we wrote last time. You remember to define gauge invariant operator are those that also satisfy this constraint, the derivative of the operator respect to mu times a generic d mu lambda must vanish. And then you see here that if this guy is equal to a conserved current, j mu, then j mu d mu lambda up to total derivative is 0. Because up to total derivative is equal to mu j mu, which is 0. So this was a generalization, a small generalization of this. But this identifies that j mu must match with the L in the A mu. Okay? On the other hand, j mu, if it's conserved current, is also equal to its the definition of conserved current, which is dl in d. Oh. dl in d mu phi r delta phi r. So if you want to have a chance to have a gauge invariant Lagrangian, this j mu must match with this. Okay? So get the constraint that dl in d a mu must be equal to dl in d mu phi r delta phi r. Delta phi r was the variation of the field under the symmetry under which there was a conserved current. So this relation must hold. Okay? Let me bring it one on the other side. So this also must hold. Now L is a function of phi r, d mu phi r, and a mu. In particular, d mu phi r and a mu. So what does it mean that dl in d mu minus dl in d mu phi r delta phi r is equal to 0? It means that there is some particular gradient of this function L in some direction, which is equal to zero. Right? So if you have f of x and y, right? If you do df in dxi times some vi is equal to zero, it means this gradient must be orthogonal to this vector. It means there is some direction under which this function does not depend on. Or if you want, this function must only depend on combinations which are orthogonal to this vi. In this case, vi is 1 here and delta phi r here. Which means that the Lagrangian must be a function, not a generic function independently of d mu phi r and a mu, must a combination of these guys which are orthogonal to 1 delta phi r, which means this type of combination, d mu phi r plus delta phi r a mu. So that when you take the derivative with respect to mu, you get delta phi r minus the derivative with respect to phi r times delta phi r is equal to 0. These objects here are also called covariant derivatives. Is it clear the logical steps in mathematics? And in fact, now you can easily check that if you take these combinations of fields, with a mu appearing the Lagrangian only in this combination here, then the Lagrangian is cage invariant. So if you write here the covariant derivative. So a mu doesn't appear generically dependent in terms of e mu and the current, but appear exactly in this combination. So d mu phi is exactly this guy here. In this case, it will be d mu phi plus I q a mu phi, because delta phi was I q phi, right? Now, if you expand this term, you'll get indeed a combination which is a, in the cross term, you get a mu d mu phi phi dag I q with the derivative, which is exactly the one proportional to the current. And then you also get a mu squared tens, but with a different coefficient. It will not be a 2 like before, it will be only 1. All these arguments actually work at the linear level, in the sense that this is a necessary condition in order to have gauge invariant, but I expanded in lambda. So this only guarantees that at the leading order in the gauge transformation of the Lagrangian, thing works, so that the Lagrangian is gauge invariant. But you need to require that any finite gauge transformation with lambda finite, not infinitesimal, also maintain Lagrangian gauge invariant. And in order to do that, we'll see that it's not enough to transform the gauge fields. We'll require also the other fields to actually transform them trivially. And the reason for this is the fact that from this term here, you can get terms which are a mu times some d mu of some scalar field. And the mu, if you have such a term, this will mix the gauge field with the scalar field. So if you remember, the problem of gauge imbalance was also related to the fact that inside the mu there was a scalar field. Let me call it the mu small phi, which was the longitudinal component, which we didn't want in the theory because we want only two polarizations for mu. Now, when you have scalar fields, what happens is that from a mu j mu, you generate mixings between the unphysical polarization, the mu small phi, and the mu of some phi here. Because of this mixing, your unphysical polarization mixes with your physical degrees of freedom. So you need to require a mixed transformation to get rid completely of this extra degrees of freedom phi. So now we're going to start again with another formalism that implements automatically all this automatically.
Okay, what was the logic that you put it to zero to different dl by dn minus d by dn psi r equal to zero?
Here? Yes?
Yes.
Sorry,
was
this
a
question?
Which was your logic to make it equal actually?
The logic was the following. In order this to be equal to this, you require the dl in the mu times the mu lambda must be equal to zero. Okay? Now, if this guy here is a conserved current, then it's automatic because this is up to total derivative, is equal to d mu j mu, which is zero. So we are in business if dl in d a mu is equal to a conserved current. Okay? If dl in d mu, so I require that dl in d mu is equal to a conserved current. This is the form of the conserved current. Then I bring it on the other side and get this. So now, what I'm going to do next is allowing also the fields phi to actually transform under a gauge transformation. So I will implement my gauge transformation not only by shifting a mu by something that is proportional to lambda, but I will also transform phi with something that depends on lambda in such a way that the whole Lagrangian is invariant for any finite gauge transformation. So it's like saying that, you remember this lambda was removing degrees of freedom. It's like now the degrees of freedom that is removing is half in a mu and half in the field phi. It's mixed. And in fact, having a symmetry allows you to do that because now what I'm going to do is to perform a gauge transformation of the field phi exactly using the symmetry. I will use the transformation of the symmetry transformation of phi that goes into phi alpha q phi. I will just upgrade this transformation to now a gauge transformation, which involves the parameter lambda. Okay? Instead of alpha, I now consider x dependent transformation. Okay. So, if you have any question about this blackboard, make it now, otherwise I will erase everything. Okay, so first let me introduce an object. I'm going to introduce a non-local operator, a non-local operation which is called a Wilson line. Okay. What it is? So a Wilson line over a path C between 2 points Y and X is going to be the exponent of the integral for the path C between x and y of dx mu a mu of prime. And C, so C is just some path that connects x with y. So given a path connects x and y, I introduce this Wilson line, which is the exponent of the integral of a mu, the line integral along this path. So it will depend on x, y, and actually it will depend on the path. It's just a non-local. It's non-local because it depends on the operator at different points, all along the on the path. And this is useful for its properties of transformations under gauge transformation. In particular, if you perform a gauge transformation in mu, it goes into mu plus d mu lambda, then you see that the integral here will shift by total derivative. Total derivative is not zero because this is open integral, it will be the difference between the value of lambda at y and the values of lambda at x. So wc of y and x under a gauge transformation will transform into itself times some phases e to the I lambda of x minus lambda of y. So it will depend or lambda of y minus lambda of x. So e to I lambda of y and we have it here x e to I lambda of y. So it will transform like a phase minus I lambda for x and a phase I to e to the I lambda for y.
Y x on G x.
Huh?
The argument inside the Wilson line.
G x.
Y
is an
x.
The other W. Before the arrow.
Here. Y and x.
Ah, okay.
Okay. Can introduce also the notation with an extra q index, just add a constant in form of q, and this will transform just with an extra q. This is just a prefactor. Okay? I can choose contours that are closed from loops. So in this case, we talk about Wilson loops in case C is closed. And in this case, the Wilson loop is invariant under H transformation because it goes back to itself and the two faces cancel. So the Wilson loop is an local operator which is a gauge invariant, so it's an observable. And in fact, you can see that this gauge invariant also manifests by the fact that the integral, the line integral of a mu along a closed path by Stokes' theorem is also equal to the integral over any surface that has S boundary C, the contour itself, of the external derivative of a mu, which is the field strength F mu nu, times the surface element, the sigma mu. So it's the flux through the surface of the electromagnetic field, which is gauge invariant by construction. So it's manifestly gauge invariant.
Are all the objects that are gauge invariant physical?
Yeah, if you have a
observable.
Yeah, observable gauge invariant operator which are Hermitian. So if you have a gauge invariant Hermitian operator, in principle it's observable.
It's an Einstein on the if condition?
Huh?
An Einstein on the if condition?
I guess so.
Okay.
How can you just give new last line?
The last what? Stokes theorem. How did I wrote this?
Yes.
By Stokes theorem. Because this is the integral of a one-fold, this is the integral of a vector, a line integral. So by Stokes theorem is also equal to the integral of a surface under, which is contained by the stereo derivative of a mu, and the stereo derivative of a mu is redefined. Okay, so this is just a definition, if you like. Now let's consider a field, for example a scalar field, but it can actually be any other field, phi of x, that whose Lagrangian is a global symmetry, a U1 global symmetry, so it transforms as a phase. So as I said before, let's consider now, let me transform the field instead with a constant phase, with an x-dependent phase, alpha of x, as if it's a gauge transformation, okay? You see, any invariant that you can build, U1 invariant, you can build with phi, that doesn't involve derivatives, will still be invariant under a transformation which is space-time dependent. But if you have derivatives of phi, a d mu phi of x does not transform covariantly, because d mu phi of x will transform into a d mu of e to the I q alpha phi, which is equal to e to the I alpha q phi plus I q d mu alpha phi. So now you have an extra piece. What did I do?
A d mu.
Beside the term here, which is the covariant part, where the phase just appears in front of the whole object, you get an extra contribution where the derivative acts on the face itself. So now, if you have an object which is, which was invariant under a global phase transformation, will no longer be invariant because you have x at n which are proportional to mu alpha. The reason for this is that the derivative is actually is nothing else than a difference of the field between two different points in space. And if now we rotate with a different phase the field at different points in space, then the derivative is actually the difference between two objects which transform with different phases. So because of this, of course, the derivative is not a covariant object. It's like when you combine objects that have different representation properties, you will not get. Okay, so now we can employ this object here to make the derivative covariant. How we do this? Well, so take your field psi of x and multiply by a Wilson line q between y and x. Let me call this phi tilde of y and x. It's like a field which is pointing in x, and then on x you attach a Wilson line until y. Right? It's the product of a field at x and a Wilson line that goes from x to y. So it's not local now. It's not local, but under a gauge transformation, you see that phi transforms with a phase which is I q alpha, and the Wilson line transforms with e to the minus I q lambda a to the I q lambda. So let me choose alpha equal to lambda. So perform now a transformation here, choosing here lambda. And this object here will transform. You see the phase from the field here exactly cancelled with the phase here. It will be left only with the phase in y. So this guy here will transform as if it's a local operator at y instead of x. Now it's easy to make derivative with respect to x because it doesn't transform under anything depend on x. So if I take d mu of phi tilde of y x, this guy transforms covariantly because it will transform into something that goes like e to the I q lambda of y d mu of phi tilde y and x. I can bring a d mu inside. It only depends on the number one. Of course, it's not a very nice derivative because it's not local. We want eventually to write a Lagrange which is local operators. Okay. So let me bring. Let me multiply by another Wilson line, which exactly undo this path. So I take a Wilson line, which is the original one to the minus one. Go back from y to x along the same path. So I'm considering, let me consider now w minus q, if you want, of x and y, of d mu. of y and x. Now this object here under the Green transformation really transformed as e to the I cube lambda of x times itself. Because e to the I cube lambda of y is removed by this term here, and you get an extra phase depending on x. So this object transforms covariantly, and only the Green transformation only depends on the phase at x. And now we're going to show that this object is also local. Okay. So to see if it's local, just write it explicitly. Okay. This guy here is e to the minus I q, the integral between x and y of a mu then dx mu. Then I have a d mu of the Wilson line e to the I q, the integral between x and y a mu dx prime times phi of x, and that's it. Now, when the derivative acts on phi, this term cancels with this, I just get d mu phi. I have an extra term when d mu acts on this guy. D mu is the derivative with respect to x, right? So when I take a derivative with respect to x, here the x dependence appears only here. So the derivative with respect to x is just the integrand minus the integral computed at x with iq outside. So I get a minus iq a mu at x from this guy times phi of x. And the exponent still simplifies away with this. And that's it. So now you see that this operator here only depends on x. It doesn't depend on y and c. So it's a local operator in x. But by construction, it transforms covariantly. Which means that now, if I use this, this is called covariant derivative. If I use the covariant derivative instead of the normal derivative, I automatically can build gauge invariant Lagrangians. You just replace the normal derivative with the covariant derivative. The theory was invariant a global transformation. Now it's invariant under a local transformation, which is a gauge transformation. And because the derivative incorporates both the field phi and the field mu, it automatically produces non-trivial interactions between the field a mu and the charge field phi. So the general form of the Lagrangian was, actually is, the Lagrangian which depends only on the covariant derivative of phi, phi itself, and the gauge invariant combination for the field kinetic term, f mu nu. And there is no explicit dependence on mu anymore. Mu can only appear inside the covariant derivative. And this covariant derivative, if you see, if you check, is exactly the same form of the one we inferred at the linearized level by requiring that indeed mu only coupled to a conserved current.
I don't know why it is called covariant derivative. Will it obviously leave this principle?
No, it's called covariant derivative because it's a derivative that transforms covariantly under a gauge transformation. This derivative doesn't transform covariantly as an extra piece here. It doesn't transform with an overall phase. Instead, now this transforms with an overall phase in a covariant way under U1 transformation.
And it is a derivative, it should...
And it's a derivative, right? It's a derivative.
So it should obey the Leibniz principle. If it is called derivative, it should obey the Leibniz principle, Leibniz law.
Liouville.
Leibniz.
Ah, Leibniz. Yes. Yeah, it's the same definition here, but now with each piece is multiplied by Wilson line. This is a Wilson line from x to y. This is from x plus delta to y. So now there is a difference between two objects transformed in the same way. If you we just multiply this w, we just took phi tilde, which was the object with the w. So the covariant derivative, if you want, is now phi of x plus delta x with the w that goes from y to x minus plus delta x minus w y x phi x over delta x. So you move phi to y, you move x plus delta phi to y. Now these two guys transform with the same phase, so you can subtract them, and this will produce the covariant derivative, and then you move back. But it's all encoded in the formula here. Any questions? All clear? Okay, so now it's easy to construct a non-trivial interaction between gauge fields and matter fields, spin 0 and spin 1 alpha fields, that have a globally one symmetry. You just construct a covariant derivative in this way, or you can just take the definition before, the mu phi minus a mu times the variation of the field itself, so that the theory is automatically gauge invariant. You have a non-trivial interaction between a mu and charged fields. Fields must have a conserved current, so must be charged under some symmetry.
Actually, the definition is this capital D mu phi or W phi, this definition.
Of the covariant derivative?
Yeah, yeah, you define it at the upper. D mu equal to W x.
This guy is equal to this guy, which is equal to this guy. So it's equal to W minus q d mu of wq times phi. This is the definition of d mu phi. So you have to put a Wilson line, d mu and the anti-Wilson line, the inverse of the Wilson line, you get mu phi. Of course, this is just a formal demonstration. At the end, it just use the manifestly local expression.
Can we give any physics interpretation to these Wilson lines terms that define the covariant derivative?
It's the analog in geometrical terms, is the analog of the parallel transport that you will see in general relativity. There probably you have a more geometric interpretation, because the symmetry associated are external symmetries that act on space-time, but it's exactly the analog. You probably get more. It's just an operation that allow you to compare objects that will transform in different way in different point, in such a way that you can actually make a difference if they transform in the same way.
If it is analogous to parallel transport, parallel transport is on manifold space-time.
Yes.
It is on which space?
This is the internal space of the symmetry. In this case, it's also trivial because you have U1 symmetry, which is always flat. Mm-hmm. So it's just a phase. You see that you can apply this, the same machinery for non-abelian symmetry, which has a non-trivial manifold, mm-hmm, of the group, and on that manifold then yeah, the power transport analogy is more manifest. You have to basically take a difference between vectors that are non-commuting, so you have to parallel transport them to compare them, to take a difference. Okay. Okay, of course if you, well, this now become trivial, but if you go back to the fermion case, you can also in that case rewrite the QED Lagrangian we wrote before in terms of covariant derivatives. So you just write the Lagrangian in this way. Where the covariant derivative d mu of the fermion psi is just d mu psi minus iq d mu psi, exactly the same expression. Now, if you replace the guy here, you see that indeed this term here, the interaction term, is exactly the one we wrote before. It's d mu times a bar gamma mu psi. And for the scalar field, you get all the interaction generated from this term. Once you replace d mu phi with d mu phi minus iq a mu phi, modulo square will generate exactly all the interaction in a mu and a square. There will be two interaction terms. One is a mu, which is times phi dagger d mu phi, and one that involves a mu square phi modulo square. And the relative coefficient is completely fixed by gauge invariance. So gauge invariance in this case is very constraining. It tells you that you cannot have interaction that involves one gauge field and two scalar fields. You must automatically also have an interaction that involves two gauge fields and two phi fields, with exactly the coefficient is exactly related by gauge invariance. If you put the wrong coefficient here, the theory is not gauge invariant, so either you spoil Lorentz invariance or you get an extra propagating degrees of freedom. So now, because of this, you start seeing that when you do the interactions, the calculation with the interactions, in the actual computation, you get contribution from here, contribution from there, and gauge invariance is recovered only when you add up everything. Well, for the even if for the scalar field, for the U1 field, this identity is trivial, just write it down anyway. We compute the antisymmetric combination between two covariant derivatives, d mu, d nu, minus d nu, d mu, of any field phi here. And this is automatically equal to the charge of phi times f mu. This is sort of trivial. This is covariant, is gauge invariant by construction. It involves either derivative of gauge fields. So the only object which has two mu nu indices, antisymmetric, which has either derivative or mu field, is gauge invariant, is f mu. So either is f mu or is zero. But you can compute just substituting here the covariant derivative, you can compute this and you get this. Okay? So if you want, this is a way to construct the field strain out of the
Times the field.
Huh?
Times the field.
Times the field, yes, thanks.
This is also true in non-abelian case theories.
Yes. Indeed, in the U1 case, it's also trivial. In non-abelian case theories, it's actually less trivial. And it is a way to construct the fifth sense for non-abelian case theories. And actually, it's true also in gravity in GR, in GR relativity. Also, another important feature is that under charge conjugation, the current was transforming non-trivially, in particular was odd. And this is because if you want under charge conjugation, a charge fixed sign. But then charge conjugation can be an actual symmetry of our Lagrangian if and only if the charge conjugation transformation of A mu is also non-trivial. Because in the Lagrangian you have coupling J mu and mu. So the term do not break charge conjugation only if you allow A mu also to flip sign, to compensate the flipping of sign of J mu. This is sort of obvious if you think that if you change, of course, flip the sign of a charge, you expect the electric field to also flip sign for the magnetic field. So this is just implemented there. So an important aspect we want to summarize, to repeat, is that there is a deep difference between symmetries, which are associated to global transformation of the Lagrangians, and gauge transformations, which are not symmetries. So a symmetry acts non-trivially on the Hilbert space. So if you have a state psi, and you perform a symmetry, you transform in a different state, you rotate. If you have particle associated to some multiplet under, like I say, SON symmetry, they will rotate. So you map a state in a different state. On the other hand, gauge transformation, by definition, we said that we will restrict only physical states. So the operators that define any transformation must be gauge invariant. So they cannot change the state. They are automatically singlet under the transformation. They are gauge invariant. So the state is automatically, in other words, you never see a non-trivial transformation, different state associated to the same gauge transformation. So if you want gauge transformation, it's a redundancy. It's a tool that allows you to write something that will have only a limited number of degrees of freedom into something that has more spurious degrees of freedom, but is manifestly Lorentz invariant, like our A mu field, right? You have only two polarizations, you have a spurious one, so you can write a four vector, keeping also this spurious degrees of freedom, but Lorentz invariant manifest. And then the redundancy allows you to get rid of the spurious degrees of freedom, which will not enter the physical processes. So there are two very distinct things. Sometimes they are mixed by the fact that in order to write interactions of gauge fields, you need also global symmetry. And then, as we saw with the covariant derivative, the gauge transformation also exploit the global transformation. But you get the same current only because of the global symmetry. You could have gauge fields without any global symmetry. If you take a free photon, or without charged objects, you get a non-trivial interaction. You can get a non-trivial interaction in both F mu, but no U1 symmetries. And you can have gauge transformations also without gauge fields, without vector fields. Can only have scalars, for example. Is this clear? So to show very rapidly this last common enemy, just want you to look at a very simple example. Imagine that you start with your Dirac equation, which has a U1 invariant global transformation. This theory here is not gauge invariant, right? There is a U1 global transformation, there is no gauge invariant. I can make any Lagrangian gauge invariant without changing the physics, without adding any spin-1 field. So there is a very easy way. I can make this Lagrangian gauge invariant in this way. I just take the same guy and let me add a term which is gamma mu d mu phi. So let me add a scalar field, not a vector field, a scalar field. And now I declare this Lagrangian here is gauge invariant, because indeed, if you perform the transformation psi, you go into e to the I alpha of x psi. At the same time, phi of x go into phi of x plus alpha of x. Lagrangian is invariant. You see, from d mu psi, you get a term which is I d mu alpha. I guess I didn't mean that guy here. But then also phi shift by alpha, and you get minus gamma mu d mu alpha, which exactly cancels the d mu alpha you was getting from here, and the rest of the Lagrangian is invariant. So now this Lagrangian here is gauge invariant. Okay? And it doesn't involve any photon. And it's actually equivalent to this. I didn't change any physics. An easy way to see this is the following. This is gauge invariant. It means that physics is not, does not depend on the choice of alpha of x. It's invariant. So let me choose alpha of x. Let me gauge fix the theory by choosing alpha of x such that phi is equal to 0. I can only can always do this, because whatever phi is, I choose alpha equal to minus phi. So if I take phi equal to 0, bam, I get back this. So if you want, this is the gauge fixed version of this. So what I did was to add an extra degree of freedom plus a gauge invariance. The gauge invariance, what it does, it removes the degrees of freedom. So I go back to the original level without changing physics. And actually, one can show that you can always do this. Whatever Lagrangian you have is equivalent to a gauge invariant Lagrangian with exactly the same physics. So gauge invariance per se is not doing anything, except to remove degrees of freedom. It's not just by requiring the theory is gauge invariant that you gain for free the interaction with the photon. Okay? It's the opposite. You put the photon there, and then to get rid of the extra degrees of freedom of the photon, you have to require gauge invariant.
So what would be the example of the symmetry of this Lagrangian?
Huh?
You show the example of gauge invariant.
Yes.
What about the symmetry of this Lagrangian?
Of this one?
Yes.
Exactly the same symmetry as this. There is a global symmetry, which is psi goes to e to the I alpha constant psi. It's still a symmetry of this Lagrangian. And there is a conserved current for that. Exactly the same. On top of that, there is an extra gauge invariance. And the gauge invariance, all it does is it removes this extra spurious degrees of freedom, 5x, that we added by hand here. So we added an extra field, but in doing so, we also added a gauge invariance. And a gauge invariance removes fields, because it tells you that your Lagrangian does not depend on some x-dependent combination. So it means that some of the fields there are not physical. For the vector field, it removes some polarization. For the scalar field, it really kills the field, because it's only one. It's already only one degree of freedom. Actually, the same you can do for a massive vector. You can write a vector field, and you can add a mass by hand. If you add the mass, explicitly break gauge invariance. I can always rewrite that in a gauge invariant way. So I can always add the mass. This trick on making gauge invariance, Lagrangian gauge invariance, is called Stukenberg. Okay? Stukenberg. that's a challenge. Maybe there are two dots here. Or there. So I'll finish with the vector field, okay? So imagine you start with a photon Lagrangian, and you add by hand a master. Then you also add a coupling to a current, but now the current is non-conserved. Okay? So it breaks gauge invariance. I just add here any vectorial field combination. I can make this Lagrangian gauge invariant without changing the physics. Okay? How do I let? Let me replace a mu with the combination A mu minus d mu phi over n. Or plus, doesn't matter. Okay. So my new Lagrangian is, so if I do this, let me write it in this way, d mu phi minus a mu m square 1/2. See, if you pull out m, you get m square 1/2, and this combination inside. And then that term, let me write it, say d mu phi minus m a mu j mu over m.
What about the f mu?
F mu was already gauge invariant. I didn't. So if you replace this, since you have d nu, a mu antisymmetric, d mu antisymmetric and phi 0. So it doesn't do anything. Okay. So what is a gauge invariance here? Gauge invariance is simple. It's this transformation. A mu goes in a mu plus d mu lambda. And phi goes into phi plus n lambda. If you perform this couple transformations, this combination is actually invariant. So this combination are invariant per se. So the full Lagrangian is invariant. In fact, you can derive this by a symmetry. This phi field, if you see, if lambda is a constant, is like a symmetry where phi shifts by a constant. And the covariant derivative for this symmetry, remember, by construction, the covariant derivative is mu phi minus delta phi times mu. If delta phi is a constant, for example, m, this is the covariant derivative for the gauging of a shift symmetry. So this I can rewrite also as a more characteristic form. Manifest the gauging value. And as before, I can always choose the gauge where lambda is exactly equal to minus phi over m, so that phi is equal to 0. And if you put phi equal to 0, you recover the original Lagrangian. So I can interpret the original Lagrangian as the gauge fixed version of the gauge invariant Lagrangian. But now you see, what I actually did. In this Lagrangian here, I have a gauge field, gauge invariant Lagrangian, so I have a gauge field, a vector which only propagates two polarization, but I have an exascalar. So in total, I have 3 degrees of freedom. 2 polarizations for the vector field, for the photon, and 1 scalar. In the original Lagrangian, I had only vector field, but without gauge invariant. So he had 3 polarizations. So the number of degrees of freedom didn't change. I didn't do anything. I just reinterpret the same degrees of freedom in a different way. So here you have the gauge fields, phi, which has more degrees of freedom, a gauge invariant that reduces to 3. And here, I don't have gauge invariance, so I keep all 3. Of course, here I still have to impose the mu and mu equal to 0, otherwise the 0 component of mu is problematic. So I still have to kill 1 degree of freedom there. This is not gauge invariance, it's just a constraint, the mu and mu equal to 0. But then I will be left with all 3 propagating degrees of freedom. So this phi field here is nothing else than the longitudinal component of mu. That I pulled out, I treated as separate, and here is inside the mu, is the propagating longitudinal component. In fact, here you can see that from the cos term here, in the cos term here, there is a term which is e mu phi times a mu. So it's a quadratic piece, non diagonal, which mixes the vector and the scalar field. So this is exactly like the one I was commenting before. Inside the mu, there is a d mu phi, the longitudinal component, which mixes with phi here. So this gauge fixed Lagrangian here is also called unitary gauge. Because all the, if you want, you diagonalize this Lagrangian here. There is no mixing term. Instead, in this case, you pulled out the longitudinal component. Now you have a gauge field with only 2 polarizations, an extra scalar field, but they mix. Because actually, the scalar field, what it is the longitudinal component of mu. He knows it. He knows it by this mixing term. It's not the yard. And notice from here that now you can couple the mu also to a non-conserved current. But you cannot do this if the mass goes to 0. So you see, from here it's more apparent. If you try to send m to 0, this explodes, unless the mu is a conserved current. The exploding term is d mu phi m, But if J is a conserved current, d mu phi J is a total derivative. But if d mu phi J is not a total derivative, so if J is not a conserved current, you cannot send the mass to zero. So there is an obstruction to send the mass to zero unless you couple the vector field to a conserved current. So you can only have a coupling of a vector field with a non-conserved current if the vector field is massive. Alright. And just for completeness, I give you the two-point function of the vector, the massive vector. But I just give you the results, okay? You can realize this easily, starting from this Lagrangian, right? This is imposing mu and mu equal to zero, and now you have three propagating, like three scalar propagating degrees of freedom, creation and relation operators, you compute the time order product, and you will find this. This extra structure here derives when imposing mu and mu equal to zero. When you are at rest, you see that this term exactly removes the G00 component. You have only the spatial components. And now in a covariant form here you have P mu P nu over M square. For example, if you multiply by P mu, here you get something that do not propagate, which means that the part of this proportion to P mu do not propagate, which is a zero component. Okay, so this, if we want, is the propagator, is a two-point function for massive vector fields. So for example, we see that for weak interaction, for the W and the Z, for weak interaction which are massive, are measured by this function.
Time order, right?
Huh?
Time order.
Time order, yes. Well, depends, of course, on your path of integration, but yes. Take the path of integration or the time order product. All right.